Well, well, new year, new PC time, huh? And what a time to be in the market for a system upgrade. The new GPUs from both of the big players have me drooling, mostly because I had to sell an organ or two to get my hands on them, and the CPU market feels like it's being shaken up more regularly than my faith in humanity, which is pretty dang often. That last part is especially exciting for me since, well, the CPU market part, since I've already had a taste of what AMD's new platform has to offer, and now in this video, I'll finally be able to see how Intel plans to compete. And spoiler alert, this is going to be one hell of a fun fight. Almost as much fun as telling you about today's video sponsor Crucial and their range of impressive and affordable P3 and P3 Plus NVMe SSDs. Crucial's P3 and P3 Plus drives are designed to deliver the perfect balance between capacity, performance, and reliability at prices that actually make sense. The drives come packed with storage space all the way up to 4 TB, feature high-end NAND and controller tech directly from Big Daddy Micron, features a bunch of handy security and reliability features, and all of them are covered by 5-year warranties for extra peace of mind. The P3 range runs at about the limit of PCIe 3.0, with read speeds of up to 3500 MB per second and writes up to 3000, while the P3 Plus range kicks things into high gear with PCIe 4.0, running at up to oh-so-tasty read and write speeds of 5000 and 4200 MB per second respectively. And none of that's even the best part. The best part is pricing. Almost across the board, the P3 and P3 Plus drives regularly outperform their direct competitors while also landing at lower prices. So, if you're in the market for a big or small storage upgrade that won't break the bank, check out the P3 and P3 Plus drives via the links in the description to learn more. Or if you're in South Africa and want to pick up one of your own right now, do it at Takealot, also linked down below. Now, part of what makes this generation's CPU dogfight a little more exciting than most is the fact that for the first time in a long time, Team Red is the one coming in with a brand new, well, everything. Almost everything, at least. While Intel's the one fighting on home turf this time. Team Red made the switch to LGA for their desktop processors, meaning pins on the motherboard rather than the CPU, and it's their first desktop platform to support DDR5. Meanwhile, Intel has already been there and done that, along with a couple of other things with their 12th gen lineup. So, instead of worrying like about reinventing the wheel like they did not too long ago, and like AMD did just a few months ago, Intel kept the wheel and just banged the heck out of it until it got bigger, spun faster, and got more traction. Or something. I don't know wheel terms. Anyway, the new Raptor Lake chips and the motherboards basically serve to improve on everything Intel did last time as much as possible, and from a specs perspective alone, it's hard to argue with the result. Well, maybe not so much when it comes to the new motherboards. To me, it looks like the new 700 series chipsets mostly exist just so that Intel can launch new boards because they know people will buy them. Because new equals better, right? Well, kinda, but not really. Performance-wise, you should be getting pretty much the same experience on a 700 series motherboard as you'd get with a 600 series board. Both also give you the option of using either DDR4 or 5 depending on the motherboard, which I wish AMD had done too since the DDR5 is still pretty expensive. The only real upgrade that you should be looking out for with these new boards is native speeds boosts to like DDR5 and a few more PCIe 4.0 lanes, though at the cost of some 3.0 lanes. Oh, and the new boards don't support Intel Optane. RIP. A bit of a downer there really, but luckily any excitement sucked out of the room by the new chipset is way more than offset by the 13th gen chips themselves. Specs wise, these things blow their 12th gen equivalents out of the water, enough so that if I had bought a 12th gen part, I might be a little miffed right about now. Core count is probably the most exciting part of the 13th gen lineup, because these things are friggin' stacked. The 13900K ships with 24 cores, 8 of which are high performance cores with hyper-threading enabled, and the rest being made up of efficiency cores for a grand total of 32 threads, 8 more than the 12900K. The 13600K also gets a good bump, coming in with 6P cores with hyper-threading enabled, and 8E cores for a grand total of 20 threads, 4 more than the 12600K. The extra cores also get a nice boost to clock speeds while they're at it, with the 13900K blasting past its predecessor's max of 5.2 GHz to land at an eye-watering 5.8 GHz, and the 13600K landing at a more modest but still impressive 5.1 GHz compared to the 12600K's 4.9. All while the new E cores also support higher clocks across the board. The 13900 and 13600K are also strapped with more cache for a total of 36 and 24 MB respectively, and both receive a healthy or unhealthy boost to max server power, with the i9 rated to boost as high as 253 watts and the i5 chugging down 181 watts. Pricing is the last and probably most important spec to take note of here. The 13900K will set you back around $600 or 14,000 Rand here in South Africa, while the 13600K can be had for $320 or 7400 RAM, which puts them almost bang on the launch prices of the chips they're replacing, which is nice. As for right now though, they might seem a little pricey when compared to their direct competition, especially with AMD's non-X 7000 series chips crashing through the door. The i9's opponent, the 7950X, can be had for about $570, while the new Ryzen 5 and 7 chips will set you back between $230 for the 7600 and $345 for the 7700X. It's not a big price gap, at least at the high end, and even at the low end if you're looking at something like the 7700, but it's a gap all the same. That being said, Intel might still have the value advantage here, since, like I mentioned earlier, you can opt for a cheaper 600 series motherboard and DDR4 to cut costs if you're okay with losing out on some future upgrades like faster DDR5. But all of that only matters if these new chips actually have the performance to help justify their slight price premium, so I think it's about time we dropkick them into the benchmark Battle Royale. All the test systems we used were equipped with MSI's RX 6900XT Gaming Trio Plus, since that's the fastest GPU I have on hand, Antec's signature 1000 watt power supply, MSI's Core Liquid 360R cooler, and Crucial's P5 Plus for storage. The last gen system ran 32 gigs of Crucial's Ballistics RGB, clocked at 3600 MHz CL16, and slotted into MSI's X570 Ace motherboard, while the two current gen systems both ran a single 32 gig kit of Crucial's new DDR5 clocked at 5600 MHz CL38. The AMD system was equipped with MSI's Pro X670P, while the Intel system was also rocking an MSI Pro Series board, specifically the Pro Z790P. Okay, let's get into it, starting with a couple of productivity benchmarks. And first up, as always, a Cinebench drag race. And just wow. Not only does the new i9 absolutely dominate in the multi-threaded test, as well it should since it has by far the most cores out of the bunch, but it also managed a pretty decisive win in the single core test. All while the new i5 just barely loses to the 7900X in single core and takes third place in multi-core, which is just silly considering it beats out both iterations of the 5800X. Blender results in another clean sweep for the 13900K, again, as it should given its huge thread advantage. What's more interesting though is that the i5 again manages to basically dominate the 5800X and X3D. Puget Bench's Photoshop and Premiere Pro benchmarks paint a fairly similar picture, only in these tests, both Intel chips take the top spots, with the i5 even managing to beat the beastly 7900X, though I'm sure Intel's integrated graphics and the way it works with Adobe software helped a lot here. 7-Zip is another interesting one where the gap between the i9 and the Ryzen 9 closes significantly, while the i5 falters when it comes to decompression, but somehow manages to come out on top when it comes to compression. Weird. Obviously, all of the chips listed here are great picks for productivity, but I'm very pleasantly surprised by both Intel's heavy hitters, especially the i5, which has no business competing with the likes of the 5800X or X3D, but totally does. Anyway, productivity benchmarks are important and all, but it's time to get to what we've all been waiting for, gaming. And first up are two prerequisite synthetic benchmarks. In Unigen superposition, the i9 comes out ahead of the pack by a relatively small margin, while the new i5 and surprisingly 7900X bring up the rear. In TimeSpy, the i9 takes the lead again, though a much more substantial one this time, while the i5 lands in a somewhat close second. Moving on to real games that we can actually play, let's start with Civilization 6. And here's the first instance where the 7900X comes out on top, though just barely. Also, man, that a little i5 is impressive. Anyway, Cyberpunk is up next, and it's a bit of a weird one. At 1080p, it's not the new i9 or Ryzen 9 taking the top spot, but the plucky 5800X3D, and not by an insignificant margin at that. When we jump to 1440p though, all the chips hit a GPU bottleneck except for the 7900X, which handily breaks through that barrier. In Spider-Man Remastered, the top spot goes firmly to the 13900K, while the 13600K comes in third place, not too far behind the X3D. Something that we see again with the jump to 1440p. Oh, and speaking of 1440p, I'll only be showing those results if there's actually anything interesting to see, since we're hitting a firm GPU bottleneck at that resolution with the 6900XT. Anyway, we start to see a bit of a trend developing when it comes to other games in the stack, including Hitman 3, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, and Borderlands 3, where the 13900K and 5800X3D battle that out for supremacy, while the 13600K dukes it out with the 7900X, which should go without saying is hella impressive in its own right. Meanwhile, Assassin's Creed Valhalla, God of War, and Horizon Zero Dawn clearly favor Team Red to varying degrees, with the top slots going securely to the X3D and 7900X. While both Far Cry titles and The Witcher 3 profess their undying love for Team Blue, with the Intel chips taking the W in all three. And in the case of the i9, it's a W by a very impressive margin. And to round us out, Metro Exodus and Apex Legends don't seem to care much one way or the other. Though in the case of the latter, that's probably due to the game's 300 FPS hard cap. F122 gives us a clear win for the 7900X, with the i9 not too far behind. And in the Riftbreaker, we see another clean sweep for Intel, but do keep in mind that the game wasn't optimized for the 7900X at the time of testing. Overall, this was one of the most exciting rounds of benchmarking I've ever done. Intel is really bringing the heat with their 13th gen lineup, with the 13900K taking the top spot in more than half of the games tested, and in a lot of those cases, by a heckin' lot. And the 13600K easily managed to outpace the 5800X and traded blows with the 7900X way more than I imagined it would. The only snag for Intel here is the same one that AMD faced in my 7900X review, and that's the existence of the 5800X 3D. Which, even though it's lacking in core count and raw clock speed, continues to impress thanks to its stupendous amount of cache. That being said, just like the 7900X, I believe Intel's new chips are being hamstrung by the single module of DDR5 I used here for testing. 5600 MHz is pretty fast, but the looser CL38 timings aren't ideal, especially in games that benefit a lot from tighter timings. And even though DDR5 modules are technically dual channel, there are proven performance uplifts from using two modules instead of one. But even with non-optimal memory, the 13900K still walks out as the overall champion, while the 13600K lands in 4th place, just barely behind the 7900X, which again is not a bad spot to be in at all, since it's not even supposed to be in the same class, when it just comes in way cheaper. To help make sense of these results, we should probably take a quick look at clock speed, power, and thermals. And if you thought you could get away with anything less than a beefy cooler with at least a 360mm rad, I've got some bad news for you. The new i9 proves that Intel is brute-forcing performance on these things by pumping as much power into them as possible. And in my case, that worked out to a max of 263 watts, which saw the chip regularly maxing out at 100 degrees C. The 13600K also guzzles rather than sips power at 191 watts, even more than the 7900X, and it also ended up maxing out at 100 degrees. Both Intel chips did hit their respective max boost clocks of 5.1 and 5.8 GHz, but they did struggle to maintain anything near that under sustained workloads, with the i5 averaging around like 4.8 GHz on the performance cores and the i9 sticking to around 4.9. Even though the power draw and temperatures of the new 13th gen chips seem a bit unreasonable, that's only because we're looking at maximum values here. The new chips only managed to hit 100 degrees C while under heavy, extended workloads like rendering, but came nowhere near that during like regular use or during any of the gaming benchmarks. But still, Intel is pushing these things as hard as they can go, which is definitely not a bad thing, but you will need a good cooler to keep up with them. Okay, so now that we've got all the numbers to work with, are Intel's new darlings actually worth picking up? Well, yes, but also it's a bit more complicated. On the one hand, the new chips impressed when it came to productivity, an area where Team Red has historically been the overall champ. The 13900K completely dominated, although it's a slightly hollow victory since I didn't have a 7950X to compare it to. But to me, the real standout here was the 13600K, which shined as a phenomenal chip for more budget-minded creators. Both chips also more than proved their gaming prowess, with the i9 coming out on top, and the i5 easily holding its own against the X3D and 7900X. And like I mentioned before, with a proper kit of DDR5, you know, one with at least two modules, I'm betting all three of the current gen chips would have left the last gen parts way out in the dust. So, what's the holdup here? Well, if you have a decent budget to work with, then there is no holdup. New chips rock, plain and simple. But if you're on a tighter budget, then the price of entry might be a little high. Yes, compared to AMD, where you don't really have much choice when it comes to motherboards or RAM, Intel does seem like the overall value king, even though the chips themselves are a little pricier. But let's not forget how hot and how much power these things chug back during their benchmark. Depending on what you have already, you might have to add the cost of a good cooler and power supply to your overall cost on top of the pricey chips themselves. A cost that, what I gather from tons of my fellow reviewers, isn't something you'll need to worry about at all with Team Red's new non-X chips. And while it's not really a big deal to most of us who keep our systems for like a good couple of years, if you're looking for a platform with a clear upgrade path, then you're probably out of luck. It looks like Intel is moving to a brand new socket for their upcoming 14th gen chips, while Team Red is supposedly supporting AM5 until at least 2025. Of course, you should never buy a promise, but it's still something to keep in mind if you're the type to upgrade your system regularly. Okay, so time to wrap this up. Intel's 13900K is an absolute monster of a chip. No matter what you use your system for, in most cases, it will be the best CPU for the job right now, at least until certain X3D chips launch. But even so, it's the 13600K that stole my heart as probably the best mid-range-ish CPU I've ever worked with. One that's probably perfect for 95% of the people watching this video. Whether you're a gamer, a streamer, or like all of the above, and you do some professional work on the side. It's just amazing. Just make sure you have the power supply and a good cooler to tame these beasts, and you won't be disappointed. And yeah, thanks for watching. Remember to check out the links in the description below to learn more about Crucial's impressive P3 and P3 Plus range of SSDs. And if you're in South Africa and ready to pull the trigger, pick up the SSDs and anything else for that matter at TakeLot, also linked down below. Yeah, cheers. Oh, it's so hot.